Hey everyone, welcome to another Painting with Jay. As always, my name is Jay, so come paint along. Grab a brush, grab some models, grab some paints, paint along with me, let's rid the world of unpainted models. Have a good time doing it. Get work done. Yes. And as always, I'm working on my Space Marines, I'm back to working on my Vanilla Marines, and today I'm just working on 15 Tactical Marines. I'll be probably just putting shades on and then starting the reds. Yeah. You know, not too crazy of stuff. Just working on them, trying to get them done, trying to get my Vanilla Marines army as big as I possibly can. So, yeah, grab a brush, let's paint along, let's talk. Hey everyone, so today we work on a bunch of Marines. Obviously I'm wearing gloves because I was just airbrushing the Marines. Getting the base colors down, and now I'll just, you know, shade them. I'll use Soft Body Black to do the shading. It's a great color. I kind of regret not picking up more of it. I should have picked it more when I was at Gen Con. But I'll be talking about Gen Con in a moment. Yeah. Might as well talk about it. I've had a crazy couple weeks. Sorry about no videos last week. I was in a lot of pain. Well, I did put my Gen Con vlogs. But, yeah, I gotta get more Secret Body Black. Soft Black. And I'll talk about it all today. So yeah, it's been an interesting couple of weeks. So, start off with my trip to Gen Con. Let's talk about that first, because it's all going in order anyway. So Gen Con was amazing. It was a great time, as I was looking forward to it. Not a lot of YouTubers went, actually. It was quite surprising. So right now I'm adding Soft Body Black into the recesses. Just to do some post-shading. And people wonder why I do post-shading. It's because I airbrush first. And if you do like a zenithal approach with an airbrush, you post-shade afterwards. You know, it's that way you take advantage of the highlights, and then you can just add some shading into it. So what was I saying? Yeah, it's a great time. Not a lot of YouTubers went. I only saw a couple. I saw Trinaholic, Bill, and his wife. I took a selfie beside them. They didn't actually notice I was there, so I just took a selfie beside them and left. It was kind of funny. And then I talked with Adam a couple times. Adam Smesher. From Tabletop Minions. So that was good. But yeah, not a lot of YouTubers. And then, of course, you know, Chung from WGC and stuff. But Chung is not making videos lately. He's kind of taking a break from making videos. We'll talk about that one after. So yeah, there weren't a lot of YouTubers there this year. I noticed that compared to last year, where there was like Austin and stuff, and more people. So I hung out with primarily the WGC as I normally do. I got to chill with some viewers, my friends Tim and Jeff. Have a good time with that. So I hung a lot with the WGC, and the thing is that all the WGC people that were there were the painters, not the YouTubers. WGC is two groups. The painting group do all the tutorials and the Draconic Awards competitions and stuff, and then the YouTubers, and I'm in the YouTuber group, though I'm a bit of a painter, but, you know, not to their level, and, they don't really watch YouTube videos very often. They don't really, yeah. So, it was kind of fun, because a couple of them had no idea who I am or what I do. And I'm in the WGC myself. And, it was fun. It was just kind of interesting, you know, when they're asking about YouTube and they have no idea what I do. It's kind of fun. And I'm not, you know, with a giant ego or anything, like, wherever I go, people should know who I am or anything. But, it was kind of funny that they had no idea about a lot of stuff about YouTube, period. So, and they're part of the WGC. But they were the painters. You know, they're very talented people. And, yeah, you do a lot of good work. So that was good. What else? I got to chill. If you see my vlogs, you'll know this. I got to chill with a viewer named Josh. I had a great time with Josh. We went to a local gaming store and played a game of 40K. We filmed it. The battle report will be up in a few weeks, because I actually have the next few weeks' battle reports filmed up. And by the way, they're back, obviously. You guys got a battle report this week on Tuesday. It was the Vanilla Marines, but it was actually my first Vanilla Marines game against Stu, playing as Orcs. So Stu, if you're out there, we gotta have a rematch. Or I'm gonna try Dark Angels probably, but I want to play the new. I want to try the new Dark Angels Codex. And that'll be good. But yeah, a good time at Gen Con. What else? So the way there, let's just go over the view, in case you didn't watch the vlog. So the way there was good. I stopped in at my in-laws' house, as I normally do in London, the day before. That way I cut a third of the trip off, and I can get to, you know, Indianapolis quick. Of course, the border was fun. Yeah. The border was fun, let's just say that. I don't know. I was told, I was warned ahead of time by some friends that if you go to the American side of the border by yourself, apparently it's really conspicuous and you're very likely to get pulled over. You know, just they always do that. They pull over the single people because we look conspicuous. You know, it's basically the same idea as I watched that movie recently, We're the Millers, and he's worried that a single guy will get pulled over. Of course, he's actually carrying drugs. That's why he's worried. I was not, of course. I intentionally cleaned out my car, and I cleaned out my car, and I made sure not to bring anything unnecessary. So I was just, you know, there was nothing in my car. And, oh, did they strip search it, you know. The guy interrogated me for a while at the border, you know, asking me questions about stuff, various drug questions. And I was like, nope, don't have anything on me. I really don't. I swear I don't have anything on me. And then I was selected to get searched. And they strip searched my car for just under 45 minutes. It was like 43 minutes. And that was quite the annoyance. And the problem was, they basically told me, when I pulled over to the area, they said, now you have to get out of your car. And you got to get out of your car, and you can't touch anything. You have to, you can pick up your wallet and you can leave. You leave your car. And I think that's, I know why. I'm guessing it's because, you know, if I did have drugs somewhere in the car, I would quickly, you know, maybe they think I'd be quickly moving them on to me. And then, I'd move the drugs on to me and then walk away from the car, which they weren't going to have. So I sat in this room. It was like a kind of outside room. I don't know. Like, basically just a room with all glass windows for 40 minutes and watched them just disassemble my car. They took out the floor mats. They even went under the, I have a Ford Focus ZX5. So I have the rear tire in the trunk, not the rear tire, the spare tire in the trunk. And they went under the, like they went into it and searched it and stuff, went under my car. Like, they were really thorough. I'm confident that if I had drugs on me, that they would have found it. Of course, I don't have drugs on me. So, but yeah, so that wasn't fun. But I left a little early in case it happened. And yeah, so it wasn't the worst case, you know, just it happens. I figured deal with it, keep going. The trip itself was good. I didn't hit much traffic. I found my hotel pretty easily. When I pulled up to my hotel, I was like, oh, this is looking really shady. It's because they were doing all these renovations. So the outside, I was at La Quinta Inn in Indianapolis on the east side. And it looked terrible. Like, it looked like a construction zone when I got there. I was like, oh, no. But then the inside was nice, just because they were renovating the outside. So it's on the outside that counts. And it was good. It was affordable. And no complaints at all about the La Quinta Inn. So that was good. Yeah, I didn't spend much time there, obviously. That's the thing about the hotels. Like, I would love a downtown hotel, but they're really expensive. My friends Tim and Jeff had one, and I had one originally, and they were paying even more than I was paying originally, and it was just crazy. And the hotels downtown don't even tell you, but it's like a $30 per night car fee. If you have a car, parking there is like $30 a night. Theirs, I think, was $37. And that's American, right? Which is like 50 Canadian. So that's the thing. The Canadian dollar was extremely weak while we were there. And so a lot of the time I wanted to buy stuff, but then I'm like, oh, I can't afford it. Just, I don't have the money right now. You know, I play a little bit of War Machine and Hordes, and I collect a little bit of trolls. And ever since I saw the Glacier King, I wanted him because he looks so cool. And they had the Glacier King at the Privateer Press booth. Now, I don't know if you know about this. Now, people who don't play Privateer Press games, what Privateer Press does, so War Machine and Hordes, they do pre-releases of their models at conventions. So if you go to a convention, typically you have access to the next 2 months of their release schedule. So you go there, and that's why it's so popular at these booths, because they have models that aren't going to come out for months. So you can go home and use them in tournaments and games and have a great time and, you know, ahead of the game. Versus, you know, GW, which keeps everything really, 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 really hush-hush until, like, a week beforehand. So that was cool. GW was not really there. They had a very, very tiny, tiny presence at Gen Con, which is really, it's weird, because Games Workshop is the biggest name in wargaming, you know, to us. Like, to me, it's the war game. It's my favorite game. It's the biggest game. You know, it's weird not seeing them have a presence. And apparently, GW themselves, they all got stuck at they weren't allowed to come to the States because they accidentally revealed that they were working in the States or something like that at a convention. Because they always bring the British employees. And, yeah, they got stuck at the border. They wouldn't, or before they got on their flights, because they had visa issues or something like that. So they couldn't come. So there was no GW presence. And then Forge World, I'm getting a random phone call. But it's from this company that apparently is shady, so I'm not going to answer it. That's my ringtone for people I don't know. Eventually they'll stop. Yeah. What else? What was I talking about? Oh yeah, Forge World. Forge World, they had a decent sized booth, a little on the smaller end, but their stock levels were much lower than last year, and they were in the corner, like in the far corner, in a hidden area. It was really hard to find them. They were basically like the farthest away from the doors. Not a very good location. And then I went to Forge World early morning, day one, to see if I can get an Imperial Fists t-shirt. You know, the ones that they do, because the Forge World shirts are cool. They're really cool looking. I forgot to do the eyes here, so I better go back and do them quickly. But unfortunately, my size was already sold out by the time I got there. They only brought, like, three of each size. It was really silly. So by the time I got there, they only had mediums or double or triple XL. I forgot which one. I think it was triple XL. Yeah, triple XL that fit like a double XL. But I'm not really a double XL type of guy. So I said no. That's okay. So I didn't buy much. I bought a few things. I bought one model that I really want to paint. There's a line of chibi models from Scale 75 that is called Smog Riders, and they're really cool. So I went to their booth and picked up one. It might be one of the models that I decided I'm gonna try competition painting one or two times soon, probably next year for Adepticon. And it might be one of the models I try with, because it'd be a fun chibi model to paint up. And
what else? Yeah, I had a great time.
What I did was I helped a lot with the Badger booth, because Ken is a good, really good guy, and I like him a lot. He's a good guy. The problem is with Ken is he only brings himself, like he only goes by himself, and he always has this gigantic lineup for his airbrush, because airbrushes are becoming increasingly popular, because people like Awesome Paint Job and, you know, me and all of us we're all using airbrushes, right? People are very interested in airbrushes these days, and he always brings himself and never an employee with him. So I always just go and help, because
if I had time to kill, you know, I know a very good amount about his products, and I use them and I love them. So, and he's a good guy. I don't mind helping him out, you know, for free. I don't care, you know, and that's it. So I did that for a while, which was a lot of fun. I love selling stuff as well. It's a lot of fun, and I had fun doing that. And what else? Yeah, a really awesome time hanging out with Josh on the one day. For those of you who want the complete experience, watch my vlogs, obviously. It was hanging out with Josh was really fun. It was awesome, actually. It was a really good time. I was looking forward to it for most of the convention because, it was really nice to just get away from the craziness sometimes, because Gen Con is 55,000 people. You know, this year I think it was closer to 60 or something like that. And yeah, it's just nice to get away from the craziness. I got to just talk with them one-on-one in a quiet neighborhood. We went to a gaming store. It was really funny, actually. The first gaming store that he was intending on going to was actually closed for Gen Con, and he didn't know, so that sucked. But we went to another store, and we had a great time. Filled the battle report. I got to talk to him, got to meet him, got to know him. You know, it was really good. It was really nice to escape the craziness for a little bit and just talk with a viewer one-on-one, have a good time, hang out. And, unfortunately, another viewer emailed me. I didn't get the email until I got home. So, Mark, I'm very sorry for not answering your email. I'm not answering your email on time, but eventually I emailed him back. But, I was just, by that point, I was gone, heading back to Canada. I left around noon on Sunday. What else was cool? As I said, I hung out with the WGC people, and it was it was a little weird a couple times because they're the painters, and the painters in Chung. And the only one who really knew what I did, well, I thought the only one I knew who was Chung. I thought Chung kind of knew what I did for a living, you know, what videos I make and what content I produce. But it was as if they kind of got introduced, they got told that I'm kind of a personality, which I like being, but like I'm a battle report guy and I'm a codex review guy. I'm not a painter. They were kind of told. So the way that they were talking to me a few times, I was at one point standing around this conversation with these amazing competition painters, but one of them was kind of talking down to me. Like I didn't know what they were talking about. And I was like, I know what you're talking about. You know, I know who you are, and then, you know, just because they were kind of told that I was just a battle report guy. I don't paint, and I was like, what? You know, and not even Chung didn't even know that my most popular series is Miniature Painting 101. And I was like, you know, I do miniature tutorials. And he's like, oh, you didn't know. And to be fair though, a lot of my tutorials these days, almost all my tutorials are in, like the big tutorials are in the Warp. That will hopefully change soon. I'm going to try to do one a month for free based on the amount I've been making on Patreon. But we'll talk about more of that later. Chung didn't know that. And that's the thing. It's just, it was weird. You know, I'm not a competition level painter. I could try, which I should try. But I'm not a novice by any means. I'm not terrible, you know. And it was a little weird. I felt not necessarily insulted, because they didn't know who I was, but I don't know, it was weird just being, because I the foundation of my YouTube channel originally was painting tutorials. And these days, my most popular series is Miniature Painting 101, and then the fan favorite series is Painting with Jay, which I got a lot of feedback from. Some, you know, it's great meeting all the viewers, taking selfies with them and getting feedback, and people really liking Painting with Jay, and here I am talking to painters, and they're treating me like a noob. Yeah, it happens. But yeah, great time, great time. I'm going to go back again next year, for sure. Yeah. I'll definitely be there again next year. So the next convention I'm going to is probably Adepticon. Yeah. There might be one before that, we'll see. But probably Adepticon's my next one. Yeah, great time. It was, as I said, it was amazing meeting all the viewers. I loved it. It was by far my favorite part, was just hanging out with the viewers, talking to them, getting feedback. You know, I had so many great conversations with people. I met a guy from South Africa, which was really cool because, yeah, he came all the way from South Africa just to go to Gen Con. And he actually, he's watching my videos, he said, and he actually placed in several of the painting competitions in the speed painting. So that was really cool. So congratulations to him as well. It was funny because there were people looking for me the whole day and they couldn't find me. And I was walking around with like a giant orange shirt on, my happy painting shirt. And then I was leaving and I met a really cool guy named Mark and his friend Brent. Or Brett. His friend's Brett. Not Brent. Brett. And it was the weirdest thing, was they were looking for me the entire day and they found me when I was leaving. So we walked to our cars at the same time and we had like a good 25-minute talk. It was good because we were walking the same directions. It was really awesome meeting him. And then, yeah, he tried to contact me. Unfortunately, I was gone by the time he contacted me for one day out on Sunday, but I was gone at that point. So four done. Quarter of the way there. Just this shade. This is probably going to take me the entire video. Just because I'm talking and stuff. But it's okay. I'm getting work done, you know? Vanilla Marines are fun. What else is good? I didn't actually eat much truck food because the lineups were crazy bad this year. Like, no matter what time of the day you went, I tried various times, and no matter what time I went, it was like a 45-minute wait, and I was just not willing to do that. You know? The food looked good, but No. Had a lot of sushi. It was good. Really awesome sushi. It was probably the best sushi I've ever had at night. It's a place called Miyagi's in the north end of Indianapolis. And, yeah, Ken Badger just fell in love with the place, so we kept going. It was fun. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was a good time. Really good time. I only went to a few things. I went to, like, shows-wise. I only booked two shows that I wanted to see. Like, two entertainment events. They were both Friday night. And, unfortunately, they were both really, really bad. We went to a comedy one, not knowing what to expect. It was, like, musical comedy. But, it was really, really bad, unfortunately. Like, the singing was just, oh. Yeah, that's all I could describe. The first guy went, he was pretty good. He had some good jokes. It was all comedy through music, which I like, obviously. I get jokes. The first guy went, he was pretty good. But then, after he left, the MC made a comment like, and he was like the best one there. He was supposed to be the closer. And my friends and I all thought the same thing. We're like, oh, if he's the closer, but he was just okay, like, who is it coming up on the pipe here? And then the next person went, and he was slightly worse than and then the next one went, and by the time the fourth person went, like, everyone was just leaving, because it was such, like, the singing hurt your ears. It was such bad singing, unfortunately. So we left. Unfortunately, I didn't want to be rude, but I just couldn't, it was hurting my ears, just being in that room. So we left and then hung out for a while. I hung out with my friends Tim and Jeff for a while. And then we went to the puppet show. And the puppet show was actually our favorite thing from last year. Like, it was awesome last year. And this year wasn't. It wasn't very good. No. It was, a couple of skits were kind of funny. But, like, one sort of going, like, political. I was like, okay. Okay. With puppets. And then there was one person who, technically it's a puppet, I guess, but it's a shadow puppet. There's a shadow puppet woman. And she was just kind of improvising hand movements in front of a screen. To the tune, to Beatles music. And it made no sense. It was just no sense. It was just random hand movement like this. Like, this is her work. Kind of like that. In front of a screen. And then moving stuff across the screen. And halfway through her song, her music was still playing, she turns to the audience and goes, "Okay, I got nothing." And the audience was actually, like, more laughing at the fact that we paid to go here at this point than the humor of her work. Because it was just, I don't know. It was kind of like, you know, certain commercials make fun of art and say, you know, like, art is subjective. It was kind of like that. Like, maybe in her mind, she thought she was being artistic, but no one knew what the heck she was doing. No one. So, that was unfortunate. But, yeah. I basically went with the soul and goal to just hang out with people and have a good time. And I did. It was, as I said, I had a great time overall. It was really nice to catch up with my friends. To see people from last year. I saw people like, I saw a lot of, there's these convention people that every year I see them at the same conventions. It was cool to see them again, see how they're doing. I got to run into the guys from Cractor Studios. And they're, I was very happy to see that their Kickstarter was a success. They raised their goal and even got one of their stretch goals. So, that's great for them. I'm very happy for them. Great products. So, that was great. Yeah, good to hang out with Chung. See what he's doing. Yeah. I intentionally ate as much food as I could at the hotel. Because the convention food was just really expensive, as I said. The might as well take advantage of the free breakfasts at your hotel. I parked. I didn't end up taking the bus. The shuttles were so poorly done this year. I'm really hoping next year they reevaluate what they did. Because they finally, like, the day before Gen Con, they decided to open up the... Because of the complaints. I actually, you know, I complained to Gen Con, saying it was a little silly that... Their service was, and so did a lot of people, that their services were so poorly run because, you know, my hotel didn't even have access to the shuttles. That doesn't make any sense. Why book a hotel block if you're not going to give them access to a vehicle to get to the convention center? And so they eventually opened up, the day before Gen Con, they opened up the shuttles again to my area. But the times were just so bad. We had the option of leaving at 7 or 8 a.m. in the morning, which would put us at Gen Con at 7:30 or 8:30. Now, for those of you who don't know, most, like, the convention stores don't even open until 10. And most events don't start until, like, 9. So going there for 7:30 is just weird. And you have to leave, you know, you're leaving your... You have to be up at like 6:15 and you're exhausted by the end, right? So that was silly. And then the arrival times back home, you could either get back to the hotel at 9 p.m. or 11 p.m. And most of us, including me, had events that went well past 11 and definitely well past 9. So most of us at my hotel ended up just driving. We just drove every day. So we got parking passes, and just, the parking passes were actually pretty cheap, they're only like $6 American a day. So then we got parking passes at parking lots about half a mile, almost a kilometer away, from the convention center, and then we just parked and walked, which was cool. As I said, I didn't mind at all. It was nice to just control the time I left and not have to worry about, you know, catching a single bus, but oh man, that was really bad, the shuttles. I'm really hoping they evaluate them and just be like, no, dudes, you can't do that again. That was terrible. And I really hope they say dudes. Because It was really bad. The way that they were run this year, where just no one was happy with them. And I understand why they tried it, because they didn't want people all lining up at the same times. But if you're going to do that, you have to offer a lot of times. You can't just offer two times to each hotel block. They're, you know, two of them, one of them was reasonable, one of them was ridiculous for each time, and that's it. You know, you can't do that. That's just silly. Very silly. What else? Privateer Press tried a similar thing this year, and it worked out. You know what? A lot of us were angry or concerned. They decided to do a ticket system this year at their booth. So you lined up at the beginning. Basically, their goal was to prevent a giant lineup. So you got a ticket, and then you came back at a time, and then you bought your stuff. The only problem was, to get your ticket, you had to get into a giant lineup. So we're all here. And then I lined up. I walked from the doors to the booth. And I got like 6 hour waiting time. It was pretty crazy. But they weren't giving out that many cards, so they told me that the models I wanted would still be there. But I know a couple people who lined up with me did not get the models they wanted. Because by that point they were gone for the day. And it was silly, because we walked from the doors to the booth. And the problem was that they didn't know, the way that they kept looping the lineups around the booth in certain ways, but no one really knew where the lineups were connecting to each other, so people were unintentionally butting insanely, you know? And then certain people were getting really angry watching other people bud the line. Makes sense. So, but it ended up working out, you know, for most people, they got all the models they wanted. It was just a really weird system. And the other downside was, well, you can come back anytime after that point as well, but sometimes people had events later that day, and then they couldn't come back at the times. But, yeah. I didn't want to buy that much, so I wasn't too worried. I picked up Haley 3, which was this week's painting tutorial in the Warp. Just the one just the Major Prime version, not her kid or path or future self. So if you want to check it out, go check out the Warp. That was good. I picked up a model for my friend. And I was able to get, because Josh gave me as a gift, some Necron Tomb Blades. So I'll be building them up in the near future to get my Necron army off the ground. Maybe I'll get them back into battle reports soon. Problem is, I have so many armies right now, and Vanilla Marines are a new codex that people really want to see, and Dark Angels, again, new codex people really want to see, and Necrons are not really an army people want to see. Yeah. So what else? 32-minute mark. But yeah, good time. I'm going to go back next year. Looking forward to it. Yeah, for sure. Maybe next year I'll bring in some models for the competition. I'm definitely going to try to do one, at least for Adepticon. And I'm going to try. Like, I'm going to bring in a model that I specifically worked on for Adepticon. And see how I do. I did pick up a couple of new techniques. I was talking with Caleb, one of the painters, and he gave me a couple ideas for stuff. Also, I might have unintentionally created a category, or at least led to the creation of a category. I was painting a gnome at the Badger booth. Ken just decided to pick up a couple gnomes as a joke, and I was painting one with an airbrush. And I mentioned that it'd be cool to enter into a painting competition. Like, I was thinking of, honestly, if I was going to finish in time, I was going to enter into the Gen Con painting competition as a fun joke. It's just a, you know, fun entry. And they decided that they might create a gnome category in the Draconic Awards in the future. And I think it'd be a lot of fun to paint up gnomes. So that's kind of cool. Yeah, and then on the way home. So now it's fun to talk the next stage of my last couple weeks. So on the way home, I have a tooth. Of course I have a tooth. That doesn't sound right at all. But I have a tooth that has needed a root canal for a while. To be fair, though, I only recently, like in the last little while, obtained insurance, dental insurance, that would cover a root canal. My old dental coverage did not cover root canals, and I didn't have any pain in the tooth. It was basically a cavity that formed under an old cavity, and then that ended up knocking out the tooth. I didn't have any pain in it. So, and because my dental coverage didn't cover it, and it's expensive, it's like $1,000 for a root canal, the entire procedure. I said, screw it. If I'm not in pain, I don't have $1,000 to spend on a root canal, I'm okay. And there have been times in the past where it flared up for maybe half a day or something, it got sensitive, something got stuck in it, it went away pretty quickly. And on the way home from Gen Con, I was vlogging, and all of a sudden, the pain started again in my tooth. But this time it was a bit worse than the last time. So I stopped at a Walmart and picked up some Advil Extra Strength and kept going, thinking nothing, right? And by the time it actually popped up in my when I was talking at the end of my vlog on that day that I had a tooth pain. And by the end it was a little harder to talk, but again I figured it would blow over. Big whoop. And so I went to bed. That night, after getting home, I was really tired after, I drove pretty much straight. I stopped at a couple of places just to buy quick food and go. I got home around 10 o'clock at night from Indianapolis to Peterborough, and I got home. I was tired. Obviously I said hi to my wife and caught her up on what happened and good time. And at that point, the painkillers were kind of working, so I didn't really feel much. Went to bed, woke up, and I was in immense pain. I woke up, and I was like, wow, my face is on fire. So I went downstairs, took another Advil Extra Strength, went to bed. Again, not thinking anything was different. But in that time alone, an infection started, and I woke up on Monday, and my mouth, my mouth was like half swollen shut over the area that my tooth was sore, which is on my right side. So the entire right side of my face was swollen, like almost swollen shut. I thought, like, I woke up and I was tired, and I know I'm silly for saying this, but my first inclination was, wow, did I have a stroke or something? Because I couldn't move my face. Like, it was numb and swollen. I was like, what the heck happened? And it just turned out I had a huge abscess that needed to be dealt with. Well, except the only problem is, A, I'm relatively new to Peterborough, and of course, being the silly person that I am, I don't have a dentist yet. I had a cleanup a long time ago when I got here, but it wasn't like I have a permanent dentist. So, A, Monday was a holiday in Canada. It was a long weekend. So, of course, nothing was open. And B, anywhere that was open would only take me if I was an existing client, because they have to do tests on me, x-rays and stuff, and they weren't willing to do that. So I was out of luck. Like, I was SOL, completely out of luck on Monday. And I made a video, and I was really apologize. I put up on Facebook. I knew that last week was going to be impossible to make videos at, because I couldn't talk. And I made a video. It's in the Warp. All the Warp heads can vouch for me. I was, my face was just hilariously swollen. And then Tuesday, I woke up and my face was worse. Like, it was significantly worse Tuesday than it was Monday. Tuesday was by far the worst day I had. And I called around a bunch of dental offices now that they were open and said, hey, hi, my face swelled shut. I need a root canal, I'm guessing. And then they told me the same thing. A, their emergency services were only for existing clients. I would have to come in for tests. They weren't willing to do the root canal the same day as my tests, especially when my face is swollen. And the best part about this was I was having the most hilarious time, because my face was so swollen and I couldn't talk, trying to talk to the receptionists at these these dental offices. They weren't understanding me, and repeatedly they were saying, I'm sorry, I can't understand you. And I was like, I know, I'm in tooth problems. It was really funny and really ironic. So I eventually called around and I found a place that's not too far from my house that had an opening for Wednesday. So I went to the dentist on Wednesday. And of course, they did some tests on me, and they were like, oh, your face is really swollen. I said, yeah. And I got prescribed some really fun painkillers for my pain and some antibiotics for the giant infection in my face. So this is a lesson to you. If you have dental coverage and you have something, you know, get it taken care of. So last week I spent, and the problem is I'm the type of person, now some of you may know what I'm going through. I don't take medications at all. I'm the type of person, I don't take much at all. I don't have any prescription meds, and I'm fortunate in that way. But when I do take medications, they mess me up. Like, oh my goodness, they mess me up. And the painkillers, like, knocked me on my butt. I was, like, just, oh, the painkillers were, they relieve the pain, which is their job. But, oh my goodness, like, I was in bed for most of last week. Just, yeah. And then the antibiotics, I'm still on them, actually, at the moment. I'm out of painkillers. The pain's gone, though. Now it is. But, I'm still on the antibiotics. They gave me a 10-day... 11-day supply, 33 pills. So take every 8 hours for 33 days, you know, for 11 days, which I thought 11 days was a little odd of a number, whatever. So I'm still on them, and they still mess my stomach up. Like, they are just destroying. I've not had an appetite. And the sad part is you have to take with food, these particular antibiotics. So I haven't had an appetite, but I'm forcing myself to eat for the last week because I have to take them with food, and then once I take them, I'm just So like this painting with Jay, I'm intentionally filming the painting with Jay tonight so that I take the pills afterwards, and that way I don't need to be nauseous while taking them, because oh my gosh, that's all the feeling, you know what I'm saying, when you're just like So that's been my last week and a half. So I decided, you know what, I work really hard on my videos, but I deserved some days off. I couldn't function. And especially, like, if I can't talk legibly, I just noticed this is a Dark Angel guy. It's okay, I'll make him an Imperial Fists. If I can't talk legibly, how am I going to make videos, right? I'm a YouTuber. It doesn't make any sense. I don't want to ruin a miniature painting 101 by not even able to talk legibly. And I actually felt, and I was kind of waiting for the comments of last week's, or this Monday's Miniature Painting 101, I intentionally was willing to pull it down in case people couldn't understand me. That point, my face was still pretty swollen. After the days of antibiotics, the swelling, it started going down the next day, so Thursday, but my face was by no means back to normal until, it's basically almost back to normal now. It's been going down ever so slightly every day. I just got used to like this numbness and swelling my face for the last week. So I wasn't going to ruin a perfectly good miniature painting 101 by, you know, by just talking terribly over it. No. So that's been my last week. That's why I didn't put up much content. I did put up a Facebook posting mentioning that I was in tooth problems and that I wasn't going to be making videos or they'd be delayed. And in the end, that was it. So I put up the warp only got, unfortunately, one video. And, but they got, you know, they're back up to their normal schedule this week. The painting tutorial is up. The Q&J warp edition's up. Miniature Painting 101's up. So they're all good. And battle reports are back up, right? The battle report for this week in the warp is Imperial Fist versus Tau. And the one for free is Imperial Fists versus Orcs. Had a great time playing in Stu. So once again, Stu, you're out there. And same with Dave, but I know Dave doesn't watch these. Stu watches these. So Stu, we gotta have another match. I hear your Orcs are getting big of an army. And I want to try out the new Codex for the Dark Angels. So. But, yeah. So that's been last week, you know. And I've been doing a lot of thinking, to be honest. It's kicking my butt and making me sit down and relax has been forcing me to do a lot of thinking. And I got to think, and I'm thinking about what I want to do for the future of my YouTube channels. Because you're my confidants here. I can kind of be a little, you know, talkative with you. It's not working. It really isn't working. You know, I'm nowhere near where I kind of need to be right now. And based on a lot of recent unfortunate events, I'm finding myself actually, I'm looking at jobs again. I'm looking at jobs that will take up more of my time because they pay more, right? I'm looking at more at other jobs right now, and that's a sad feeling because at this point I was hoping to be, you know, wanting to quit my other jobs and work and just focus on my videos, and that's not the case. In fact, it's going to be the opposite. Some of the jobs I've been applying for lately, if I get them, if I get any of them, which I don't think I will, but if I get any of them, my free videos are actually going to drop significantly. Because I can't keep doing this, unfortunately, in the long term. It's been, I love it. I love making videos. I love doing this stuff. But the amount of time, you know, any of you out there who makes a battle report or any content similar to mine knows, it takes time. And a lot of time. And a lot of your resources. And in the end, you don't really get your money back. Unless you make a video that goes like quasi-viral in our niche, you know, you're at the right type of video, right time. Like right now, when Age of Sigmar first came out, a lot of Age of Sigmar videos had a lot of views. Or the occasional battle report, like one of my battle reports has tons of views compared to the others. And yeah, you make your money back on those ones, for sure. Or like for me, which I gotta get back on, I promise, absolutely promise, I'll discuss this in a second. How to Play 40K is going to be back with a vengeance, people. In fact, I'm thinking about doing like a day of only putting out those videos, and I'll see if I can do it. So in the near future, I gotta warn you, it's not working, and I gotta figure out what I want to do to fix it, because I can't continue along this path. Unfortunately, too many expenses have come up recently, and it's getting too expensive. You know, I'm not giving up 40K, I'm not giving up making videos, but I can't, you know, people. I talked with this to some viewers, and a lot of the viewers, as well as the WGC, felt this, that I give off the impression that it's easy for me to make 8 to 10 videos a week, and that I'm not in any financial ruin. And that's the thing. Out of all the other YouTubers, a lot of them, as well, like I rely on funds from The Warp and Patreon, just as a lot of other people rely on Patreon. But most of the other people are really upfront that they're broke. You know, like Ash, the guy who recently left Mini Wargaming, he was really public. He said, I'm not making videos unless I make this money because I'm broke and I need money. And people support him. You know, same with Miranda, Wargamer Girl. She says, I can't invest time into making battle reports anymore unless I get a certain amount per video and I need support from the community. And guess what? She got tons. But me, on the other hand, I am able to, on most weeks, just go and pump out 8 videos, and I use 8. Sometimes it's 10, sometimes it's a little lower, but usually the minimum's about 8, 7 or 8, between my two channels, The Warp and Free. And, you know, 2 miniature painting 101s, 2 battle reports, a painting tutorial, you know, it takes a lot of time. And people, I think, most, I was talking to viewers about this, and Josh felt this way as well, that I give off the impression that I just don't need, that I can do it, that I don't need the funding as much as other people do, and relatively, I hate asking, I really do. It's not necessarily a pride issue, but the way I was raised, in a family where funds and time were limited. And I always have been the type of person that I don't ask for something unless I really, really need it. I try to do things as much as I can on my own, and I get by on my own. And I've had to change that mentality lately because in our niche, you just can't do it. You can't. You know? And I work really hard on my videos. I'm not saying that no one else does, because they do too, you know? And I am slowly but surely taking off. But it's just not where it needs to be. So over the next few weeks, I'm going to have to give some serious thought about Patreon, The Warp, and my free content. And to be honest, something is going to have to change. Because I can't. I can't, unfortunately, keep doing this. You know, I'm not burning myself out. I'm going nowhere. And it's unfortunate. And you people are my confidants. And this is in no way a guilt trip. Please do not consider this a guilt trip to invest in me more if you don't want to. This isn't that. This is not that. I'm coming up with a few ideas. One of the ideas, which I've got a couple emails about lately, a couple of viewers have said, you know, I would love to be a part of the Warp, but I can't afford it. And I am thinking, because it's not about making the money. I'm not all about money. As I said, my goal, if I could just make a minimum wage income, I'd be okay, but I'm not making that. I am thinking about, you know, possibly changing the Warp cost, maybe, but not like permanently. Just if you really want to be in the Warp and you can't afford it and you want to, you know, maybe I can change it for you. Maybe that would be a good idea. I don't think that would be really unfair. Maybe it is slightly unfair to those people that are investing more, but anybody who's doing Patreon can do different amounts. They all get the same reward anyway, right? So, and then like even the Vault, the membership levels, there's very vast levels, you know, like there's very difference in cost between the levels. And really, to be fair, the difference in what you get is negligible. You know, if you're a gold member, you get discounts at a specific two stores that most people don't shop at in Canada. If you, you know, silver versus bronze is very little, you know, so maybe that would be the key, because that way people can, if they want to support me, they can, and they still get the Warp out of it. I don't want to price people out of the Warp. The only reason why I set the Warp at the price it is because I have to take into consideration how much YouTube is taking, right? I can't just set it at a low cost, because then I would make peanuts. But I'm not, it's not a get-rich-quick scheme. It's not about all about the money. You can only do things for so long and not succeed before you have to change your plan. So, and that yeah. And as I said, there's not a guarantee that I'm going to all of a sudden be like, no more videos for free, or I'm killing the Warp, or I'm stopped to make Patreon or something. My goal is to ultimately reward Patreon more, which is going to be to bring painting tutorials back to the free content. Maybe like one a month, depending on how much I make in Patreon, or to figure out the Warp so that make it more successful. I don't know. And let's see, I'm not hitting you up for money. I don't ever want to be known as someone who walks around. And there are YouTubers in our niche that have to do it or want to do it. The problem is, though, conversations with a lot of people lately, especially at Gen Con, have made me realize that people who don't ask don't receive in most cases. And there are people who ask every day in our niche for help. Like even Mini Wargaming, they are the biggest and baddest people on the block. But really, every video that they put out is an advertisement for the Warp. Not the Warp, the Vault. Everyone. You know, Matt asks in 2/3 of the videos that he puts out for free, he asks people to join the Warp. The Vault. Sorry. Too many ones. Right? And they're the biggest and baddest on the block. And he still asks every video. You know? Ash, who's really taking off, he asks in every video. And I just don't ever want to be that. But it's hard, because I don't also want to be the one who falls. And there's been a lot of YouTubers in our niche, and I didn't think I'd ever be one of them. And I don't think I would be one of them, to be honest. But there have been a lot of YouTubers in our niche who have kind of fallen by the wayside as of late, because our niche is high work, low reward. It really, you know, we don't put less time than, like, take Philip DeFranco, right? I don't put in less time per video than Philip DeFranco. He's just in a way more popular niche, and he's way more popular. He makes great videos. You know, it's not time, but in the bigger niches, if you are, you know, more known, you get much, it's much less risk, much more reward. So you can give up your job and be a YouTuber. but not in our niche. I'm trying. I'm really trying. And I'm going to keep trying. I don't ever want to quit because I love making videos so much. You know, it's my favorite thing to do. Applying for new jobs makes me sick, but I have to do it because I'm not making enough between my other job and this. And so I'm going to have to actually cut back. Like the hours, it's going to be a cutback on the amount of time that I have with my wife and with my work and with my my videos. If I have to do it, I have to do it. Like, I can't go into bankruptcy for my pride. You know, I can't. So, something is going to change over the next month. I'm going to figure it out. I have to. So. But yeah, I'm not. I think in the end, I think it's just going to come down to the simplest thing. I might have to start asking. And let people know. Like, hey, I know that I produce 8. That's the problem. Is that, as people keep telling me, is I produce 8 to 10 videos a week. Right? I don't look like I'm in financial need of help. Because I've been doing it. But it doesn't mean I can, you know, I've been doing it easily or successfully. I'm just a guy who works really hard at making my videos. And I think the other YouTubers could do the same thing if they gave up their lives as well. In our niche. So. But yeah. That's it. Unfortunately, sorry, I didn't mean to go on such a rant with you guys. And girls, obviously. But it's not easy. But I love what I'm doing. And that's why I'm working so hard at it. I still don't have a perfect feeling in my face. And I'm still going. And I'm going to still keep going. I just wanted to get that off my chest. Because it's frustrating, you know, in the end, it's just, yeah, it's not necessarily my pride. I hate asking for help because I know that you people out there are not, no one's in perfect financial situations. You all have kids and families and jobs, and obviously our hobby is so expensive to begin with, right? That I hate it. I hate soliciting. I really do. But at the end of the day, take this in consideration. I know exactly how much Mini Wargaming makes on their YouTube channel. I know exactly. I can tell you almost to the dollar. Mini Wargaming would not be able to support Matt or Dave, not even one of them, their salaries off what they make on their free content, which they are perfectly honest with this, and that's why I'm talking to you about it, because I kind of have an agreement with them that everything that they make public, I can make public about them, because they already mentioned it. I don't want to drop their secrets to other people. But their income doesn't even pay... It would probably pay Chris's wage, I think. Chris's wage would be covered by all of the YouTube money that they make, you know, on their free content. They're the biggest in the world. And, of course, that would pay my wage, because I don't ask that much. But I don't have that much viewers. I get tons of views. You know, I get, relative to our niche, I make 100,000 views a month, and that's pretty good. Pretty good. But it's nowhere near what I need. So, and that's my concern, people, is that I've been trying this. You know, the warp is a year old, and I've been trying to really go on my own for about just over a year. And I'm going to keep trying. But I am warning that I can't keep doing this indefinitely. I can't. There may come a day where you're going to see a painting with Jay and hear that, you know, there may be no content for, you know, I don't know. Not that much content anymore. I don't know. And the thing is, more people pay. So I'd feel really guilty killing off their content, especially the yearly subscribers. I'd probably just reimburse them. If anything ever happened to the warp. I don't think anything will ever happen to the warp. warp. I'm going to try to keep going as long as I, indefinitely, you know, with the warp. And definitely with my free stuff. I don't, this isn't a threat. I it's just reality. But I'm going to go down swinging. I'm going to try my best, my hardest, and that's a promise I will keep. But that's the thing, and it's hard because I'm juggling all these balls in the air. The warp takes more time than my free content, and my free content takes a lot of time as well. And I just, it'd be easier. It's not possible, but it'd be easier if I could do this all under the same umbrella, like Patreon or the warp or the free. Like if I could just do one, I could do one really, really well, as opposed to three, okay. No. So, but that sums up my day, my time lately. I've been giving a lot of thought because this time off, you know, all you do is think. I'm almost done. I'm probably gonna kill it soon because we're about an hour in. I didn't give you one last week. Maybe I should continue until these guys are just done. But that's it. I don't want to talk, I hate talking about money. I really do. I hate it. I hate talking about money. And I hate asking people for money. I really do. It is not my thing to do. I don't like it at all. Oh! By the way, sorry, I just got a noise on my phone. I should give a shout out. Happy birthday to Cody Roo. It's Cody Roo's 50th birthday today. And Cody Roo's been in a lot of my battle reports, and he's a great friend and supporter. So happy birthday, Cody Roo. Oh, it's also Austin's birthday. Happy birthday to Austin as well. Brush for Hire, Mr. Mustache. So happy birthday to Austin and Cody Roo, who's exactly 20 years older than Austin. That's kind of cool. Weird fact, Owen and I, Owen the cooler, we have the same birthday. Not the same year, obviously. I'm much older than him, but same day. It's kind of cool. So, that's my rant. But I'm looking forward to DevCon and Adepticon next year. And I really hope that I don't need to go take another job. But we'll see. The summer's almost over. What else have I done lately? Oh, Toronto Blue Jays. That's what I could talk about the last few minutes while I'm painting. I love the Toronto Blue Jays, and I actually went and saw a game recently. They're awesome. Like, while I was at Gen Con, they decided that they were going to go for it this year. This was going to be the year that they're going to try to make the playoffs and try to make the World Series and win. You know what? They have a good team. They tried to make it better. So they got a couple really good trades. They gave up all their future people, like all their young prospects, gone. For David Price, and for Mark Tulowitzki, Ben Revere, right? Made a couple really big name trades. We got LaTroy Hawkins. He's good. He's a pretty old relief pitcher, but he's still really good. And I was talking to Ken about this, and Ken was like, well, Jays are going for the wild card. And I said, well, you never know. Like, with this team, they could take the Yankees. And he thought it was funny. And it was really funny since then. When I went to a Gen Con, the Jays were 8 games back from the division. 2.5 games back from the wild card. No, 3 games back from the wild card, I think. And now they've won 11 games straight, 13 of their last 14 games, and they're in first place in their division. They're ahead of the Yankees by a game, or half a game. And they're, of course, they don't have the wild card because they're in first place in their division. If they lose their division, then they're in first place in the wild card. So, Jays are kicking butt now. They're a team, like, it really reminds me of, I'm an old fart, but the 93 Toronto Blue Jays when they won the World Series. Really a stacked, solid team. Also, you know, has a few really good rental players. You know, we got Ricky Henderson in 93 to be a Jay. And now we have, you know, David Price. So, Jays are kicking butt. It's just that atmosphere now. The Toronto team is just, it's changed. Like, the feeling of the Toronto Blue Jays since the trade deadline has just been astronomically different.
And it feels like they can do anything. And it's really cool. It's a cool film. So, Blue Jays. Gotta love them. Baseball. They're kicking butt, taking names. And the best part is they're facing the Yankees. They went to New York and did the impossible. They swept New York, allowing one run over three games in New York, which no one thought that they were going to do ahead of time. And they did. And now they have the Yankees coming to Toronto, which is a huge popular series. There's no tickets available unless you're a scalper or get them from a scalper. The Yankees play Toronto for the next 3 days, today, tomorrow, and Sunday. So, and if the Jays win, the Jays can win all of them because they play amazing at home. But if the Jays win two out of the three, even, which, as I said, they can win all of them. But if they win two out of three, they're a game and a half ahead of the Yankees. And it's going to be really hard for the Yankees to catch them. The Yankees aren't doing well lately. So I think the Jays, and right now the odds of the Jays making the playoffs on sports betting is like 90%, so it's pretty cool. So unless they fall apart, the Jays can win the World Series this year. Kind of hoping they face Chicago in the finals. That'd be kind of fun. I'd make a bet with Ken, because Ken Badger's from Chicago. But yeah, Jays rock. And I actually went and saw a game recently. It's cool. I've been to a couple concerts this summer, a couple more concerts. I saw Home Free. I went and saw them just to see what they're about. Home Free, the winner of NBC's The Sing Off. They were good. They did all covers, which is actually what I think they should have done, which is, it's a smart thing. They did covers of popular country songs, except for they played their song Champagne Taste on a Beer Budget. But it was a lot of country music. The funniest part is, I've seen four concerts this summer that either open or second song in is a cover of Avicii's Wake Me Up. And they did it too. They opened with Life is a Highway, which is actually a song by Tom Cochran, who's from, who lives in the same city I grew up in. Or same town. But Tom Cochran. And Life is a Highway. And then they played Avicii's Wake Me Up, right? And as I said, I don't know. I guess every band thinks that they're like doing a great cover of it. But it's kind of funny seeing four bands in the same concert series in the summer all open. Or like two of them opened and two of them, it was their second song in, was a cover of Avicii's Wake Me Up. Chad Brownlee did it. The Abrams did it. And, oh, what's the other name? I forget the other name of the band that did it. But it was one of those, the quieter bands. They were brothers, whatever they're called. But, yeah. It's kind of funny. It's a good song. But it's just weird hearing, you know, everyone play it. And for those of you who don't know, anybody who wonders, the actual singer on Avicii's Wake Me Up is Allo Black. He sings the song I'm the Man. Oh, I don't know why I'm shaving his head right now, because he's going to be white-headed. All my sergeants are going to have white heads. I'm going slightly longer than normal, because I didn't give you guys a painting with Jay last week. I felt guilty about it, but it would have been just me rambling and gibberish because of my tooth issues. Go Blue Jays. I always wanted to go to a Blue Jays game. I haven't been to one in years, so I decided to go to one this summer. I just bought a last minute ticket from a StubHub or whatever it was called, Vivid Seats. And I just went. I had good seats. I had front row seats. It was not expensive at all. really cheap, actually, because I bought it last minute, and I figured that out. If you buy a ticket, you know, 4 hours before the game, pretty cheap. I wasn't close to the bait. I was front row of my section, but I wasn't, you know. No. And I figured it'd be cool to see them, if they do make the playoffs, the playoff tickets would be way too expensive, right? I can't afford that, so. Just want to go see them. So happy birthday, Cody Roo. Or as he calls it, Spore Day. Because he's an Orc player. And that's it. He's done. We did all 15. I'm going to call it now because I'm going to have to go take my antibiotics and then that's my feeling. So let's end it now. So that concludes another Painting with Jay. I really hope you enjoyed it. By the way, if you want the I Respect That t-shirt or any other t-shirts, go to my Spreadshirt store. Link in the description below. And yeah, I really hope you got stuff done. Sorry about my rant. But as I said, sum it up. Gen Con was awesome. Tooth pain sucked. And stuff are good. Hopefully good things are coming up down the pipe. Some good changes. I'm going to work hard. I'm not going down easily. I'm going to go down swinging. So I'm going to make sure that my content's the best it's ever been. And as I said, I'm going to come back with a vengeance with how to play 40K. My goal is maybe take out one of my free days coming up and just film 4 or 5 episodes in a day. Maybe I'll just release them all on the same day. Get a whole month's worth of content done in one day. Put it all on the same day. That way you can watch it. We'll see. That would be a good way of catching up. But thank you as always for watching. I really hope you got stuff done. And to all those people, if any of you are watching that I met at Gen Con, it was awesome meeting you. And it was really cool hanging out with you. So thank you very much for watching. Hope you got stuff done. And see you tuned for next week's Painting with Jay. As always, my name is Jay. Until next time, this is Jay saying. Happy painting with me.